Every blessing you pour out, turn back to praise. Don't recognize the person around you, ask them how they think they're doing here.
Oh no.
voices to sing it out one last time. Lord, thank you that you don't quit. When you were sent to die, you didn't quit. When it got hard, and that you loved me even before I knew you, while I was still a sinner, stuck in my rut, stuck in my way, Father, you loved me. You loved us all. We love you because you first loved us, Father. Thank you for your grace and your mercy, above all your love.
You are glorious. Oh, 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 oh. anybody says you're okay. Don't you appreciate Kyle and Ron over here? No. I'm just grabbing the mic down here. It's probably about 5 degrees cooler down here than it is up here in the
city. Yeah, enjoy. Oh, he gets it.
Well, we're glad all of you are here tonight, and it's a great day. It's been raining a little bit. We need the rain, and it's okay. We need the rain. And we don't have many leaks in this building. I don't think there's any where you're sitting. Might be a few in the corners. We are blessed people. We have a God that loves us so much and cares about us. We have a God who is our friend. We have a God who loves us so much. And we should every day just stop and pause, count our blessings, thank the Lord for what he's done. I found a little story that I want to read to you. It's not too long. I think you kind of like it. It's called Forgive Your Enemies. It says, Forgive Your Enemies was the topic of the Reverend's sermon on this particular Sunday morning. At the close of his rather long message, he asked how many were willing to forgive their enemies. About half the congregation raised their hands. Well, not satisfied, the preacher preached another 20 minutes and repeated the question. This time a few more lifted their hands. Still unsatisfied, he lectured another 15 minutes and repeated the question. Now everybody in the church raised their hands except one little elderly lady on the back row, Ms. Jones. He said, Ms. Jones, aren't you willing to forgive your enemies? I don't have any, she replied. Miss Jones, that's very unusual. How old are you? Well, she said, I'm 93. Miss Jones, please come down to the front and tell the congregations how a person who is 93 years old cannot have a single enemy in the world. Well, the sweet little old lady kind of talked down the aisle very slowly. She turned around and announced, it's easy, Pastor. I just outlived them all. Ta-da! Hey, if we get anybody visiting with us for the very, very first time, we always like to give our guests a gift from the church. We won't embarrass you. We'll call out your names. We won't make you stand, but we would like to give you a gift. Anybody here for the very, very first time, then this also is a good time you can rat out somebody because they're going to actually like the gift they're going to get. Anybody? Very, very first time. All right. Well, we got a new guy in the program over here. All right. Good to have you here. Now, you'll get one of our warm fuzzies. And anybody else here? Very first time. Well, we want you to know you are very much welcome. And you've already got your picture on the wall out there, so you're in good shape, all right? And the first day you came in, I gotta tell you, you don't know this.
Pastor?
Yes.
We got another one here.
We got another one here, okay. We're gonna give you a warm fuzzy, and then we're going to ask you to wear that little warm fuzzy tonight. When you go home tonight, not to throw it in the garbage, but instead take it home with you. Put it somewhere where you'll see it in the future, like maybe on that mirror in the bathroom, maybe on that refrigerator in the kitchen, or on your computer monitor. And we hope after tonight, when you see it, remind you two things about coming to Crossroads. Number one, you found us to be a warm and friendly place that felt like home. But here's the big one. We hope after tonight, when you see the little warm fuzzy, it reminds you that when you were in our house, you felt the very presence of the Lord, If that happens, it's been a great, 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 wonderful day. And then they're giving you a little card. It's called a friendship card, and if you fill it out real quickly, when you're done, just wave it in the air. They're going to come back, crate you out of that little card, and give you one of our really neat VIP gift bags. There's some really neat stuff in here. It does change from week to week. I took a peek again this week. The ones I saw all had one of our really neat dry erasable boards, magnet boards that you can write down an important message. There is also some of our world famous Crossroads chili for 10. The bag I looked in had some hot fudge for ice cream sundae. There were about 8 other little things in there. We just want you to know you're our VIP at CCC. Thank you for being here today. All right. Well, real quickly, let me go over just a couple things I want to point out to you. First of all, if you didn't get a day, you read that last week. It's now March, and these are for the months of March, April, and May. They are free. There are some extra copies if you need an extra one, or you would like to take one to someone that's shut in, someone that maybe is in a nursing home, shelter care home, or maybe in the hospital. We do have a few extra ones that you can take, and you're welcome to them. We would like to remind you of some things that are going to happen this week that you really ought to know about. One is that this coming Thursday night, we have an awesome concert. And we have a group that's called the Needhams. They've been here several times. They do kind of a bluegrass, country style, close harmony. And Thursday night, it's a free concert, and I guarantee you will enjoy them very much. It will be a great concert to invite someone to come and see. If you got the emailer this week about the concerts, about the upcoming events, or if you go on Facebook, the church page, you will see the Needhams on there. Pass that along to somebody else. Let them know about a great concert this Thursday night. And then this weekend, our ladies will be having their monthly brunch. You'll be here from 10 to 12 noon on Saturday. You're asked to bring either a side dish, a casserole, or a fruit dish, and join the ladies. There will be a guest speaker. There'll be worship and music, and it'll be a great time of fellowship, and you are invited to come be a part of that. And then our seniors are going down to Old Sacramento on Saturday morning on the tour bus. We'll be limited to the 47 that sign up first. The neat thing about the tour bus is it's got big, comfortable reclining seats, but it also has a bathroom, so that's a pretty neat thing. And it will take you up right to the gate. You'll be let off. You don't have to do any walking. And then whenever they're getting ready to come back, they'll come back and pick you up. And you won't have to do any extra walking. That's a pretty neat deal. The cost for the entire trip is $10, and you can't hardly beat that. It's not really worth going in and driving your own vehicle, spending the money for gas, having to find a parking place, and then walk a half a mile to get to where you're going. It's kind of a neat deal. Senior trips are an awesome thing that our seniors do each month. So I'm going to ask if Edna will be out there in the lobby for a few minutes. If you haven't signed up yet, be sure and get signed up before tomorrow morning, because I have an idea to fill up tomorrow morning. And so I want to give our guys that are here tonight a chance to go from this service. And our guys over here, they've been waiting for this weekend, first weekend of the month. They've got tickets for their craft feed, their major fundraiser of the wintertime. They have to get through all this wet weather. They can't do as much work and stuff as they like to do. So this kind of helps get through and pay the bills. And they've got the table set up out there. And if you want to go to the crab feed, it's an awesome thing. You'll have plenty of crab, all you can eat, all the shrimp you can eat, all the spaghetti you can eat, all of the bread you could eat, all of the salad you could eat, and it's a great time of fellowship, and we invite you to come be a part of that. They'll be out there selling tickets tonight. And then last but not least, Easter's just around the corner. We're less than a month away now. And we always have an Easter egg hunt for our kids on Easter Sunday. And we are collecting plastic eggs full of candy, or plastic eggs that we can fill with candy, or candy, because we want to make sure the kids have, we make sure the kids have lots of Easter eggs. It's a lot of fun. There'll be prizes for them. And they can take these eggs, and when you go to grandma's house or whatever, they can re-hide them and re-hunt them again. It'd be a lot of fun. I always like for kids to have good memories about church. I like for them to know that we love them, and one of the ways we do it is by doing special things for them. So if you can help us with the Easter eggs over the next month, there's a big barrel out in the lobby. It's got a picture of candy all over. Just bring whatever candy you have and drop it in there. We empty it after every church service to make sure that all of it gets into a locked area. And then we have a big work week getting those Easter eggs ready. So anyway, thank you for listening to me tell all those announcements. We're going to have our ushers come, and we're going to receive our regular Saturday night tithes and offerings. It's the first of the month. It's the time that we bring our gifts into the storehouse, according to Malachi, and we bless the work of the kingdom. You give the way God has blessed you. Lord, we thank you. You're an awesome God. You have blessed us with so much. We are so thankful. Lord, we count it a privilege and a joy to give back to a ministry that's touching hearts and touching lives. Bless this offering, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Sing a new song. love you, we adore you, and we lift you up for no other reason than because you are worthy, Father. You're worthy of all of our praise and all of our honor and all the songs that we sing and the daily actions that we live out trying to be more like you. Lord, we love you. Our worship doesn't end with our songs. This is just a time of peace, Father, that we can all, as one body, lift you up in one accord and one mind. And right now, our hearts come together and say that you're worthy. You're worthy, Father. Thank you for your love and your mercy, and for being a great and kind God, who even though commands all the power in all the universes, you call us your children. Not your subjects, but your children. We love you. We worship you. Thank you. Before we go any farther, I just want to take 1 second, if I may. As a worship leader, it is a calling in my life to facilitate an atmosphere where we can worship. And that phrase is often misunderstood. And I just want to take a second to paint a clear picture of why I'm doing this and why we are doing this. Because sometimes people can confuse skill or musical talent with calling and with worship. And I just want to make crystal clear that what we do here, the songs that we sing, the way that we have a band or a lack thereof, that none of that really matters. And I know that you guys know this, but I just got to ring this really true to you. If these songs up here, if you're singing them because you've heard them on the radio, and it's a tune that you know, and you're thinking about your work week, and you're thinking about what's going on, and you're not thinking about the Lord, then you can sing the song as much as you want, and you haven't really in your heart worshiped the Father. So I encourage you, every single time that you're here, I have to do this more than anybody, because this is my life. I sing these songs hundreds and hundreds of times. They can become a thing, even for me, especially so. I have to renew and refresh in my heart the purpose to lift up God with these words, so that it doesn't become a routine, an action, a ritual. Our God is a living God. We have a relationship with Him. He's worth more than just empty rituals. Amen? As we sing the songs, the Holy Spirit's he's gentle and he's kind and he's good. And we often can feel the presence of the Holy Spirit. But don't be lured into experiencing worship because you want to gain something out of it, because you're here for you. You want to get the feely goods. That's a deception that I've fallen into in my earlier years. We are here to offer up something to God. He's worth our praise and our worship. That's why you hear me say that in my prayers, because I have to remind myself that over and over again. God is good, and He will show up, and you will feel Him in ways that feel this side of physical and natural. But that's a byproduct of who He is. That is not the purpose of why we lift Him up. We don't do this as a selfish thing for us. We do this because He's worth it. Amen?
Amen.
Lord, we love You. We worship You. Every song that we sing, it binds us together as a congregation with one thought in mind. One thought at a time. Whether it is Your greatness, Your goodness, or Your love, we come together to think one corporate thought at a time and lift it up to You in a form of song that You make such an amazing and powerful force in this world. We thank You that You accept our worship in the form of song, and that You hear our hearts as we lift them up to You. Father, keep us focused on You as we worship, as we continue tonight, as we pray, that You be our focus, Father, receiving from You with Your word and Your will, and offering up to You our genuine, honest praise. We love You, Lord. Lord Jesus, thank you for your presence being in this place and wanting to change our lives and make us more like you, for a love that is perfect and shows us the way. We love you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
Good evening, church. I just want to dismiss all the younger kids to their classes right now. And then for our prayer time tonight, I'm sharing out of Proverbs chapter 3, verses 5 and 6. And it says, "Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct your path." And in that scripture says to trust the Lord with all your heart. Are we trusting him in his promises, for his promises, for protection, provision, comfort, whatever it is that we have a need for? Or do we rely on our own self-sufficiency, our own understanding, our own strength? Do we stop and ask God what choice or decision does he want us to make in life? Or do we just jump into things without even asking? Because there's a lot of good things we can do, but do we acknowledge God in those things? Do we acknowledge God in every decision we make? Because when we acknowledge God, that's the key to success. Ways to a man leads to death. That's what it says in the Word of God. But the ways of the Lord leads to life and everlasting eternity. So if I can have everyone stand tonight, the prayer partners come up. Come, let us pray for a need that you may have, or provision or restoration, whatever it is, let us come in agreement tonight for you.
My feet on the side of the road, he is me, I won't let go. Fall to my knees as I lift my hands to pray. I got every reason to begin again, the Father's love that draws me in. All my eyes will see to lend to you, all I need is me. Thank you. Thank you. showed your love for me.
Each month we do communion, and communion, I've mentioned this before, it's a sacrament. In other words, it's something sacred that God has given us to physically express our faith in Him and what He has done for us. You know, God understands the tangible nature and the material nature of human beings, and because He understands the tangible human nature and material nature of human beings, He has given us something physical that transcends into the spiritual. This is one of the aspects of communion. What communion means is God has made peace between Him and man. That's what communion means. It means we now have peace between us. And so communion is a sacred event. It's not something that we take lightly. Peace doesn't come easy. Peace came with a price. Peace came with the price of Jesus Christ and His blood on the cross. And thank God for Him that we have peace. Not only do we receive the peace of God with God through Jesus Christ, but we also can exercise that peace in our families. We can have peace in our marriages. We can have peace at work. We can have peace in the midst of trials and tribulations. God has given us peace, and God has given us the ability to experience.
experience that peace in our everyday lives. He says this, and Paul says this as the Lord Jesus was sharing the Last Supper with his disciples in 1 Corinthians chapter 11. It says, the Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink of this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Amen. Let's have the ushers come forward, please.
Behold you have come over the hills, upon the mountain. To me you have brought my beloved, you've captured my heart. Behold you have come over the hills, upon love.
Special time
to pause to think about what the Lord has done for us. Tonight I want us to thank the Lord for paying the price on the cross that we could be counted as worthy. Jesus was there in the upper room on the night before he was crucified, the night he was betrayed. He was with the disciples to celebrate the Passover feast, which forever will be known to believers as the Lord's Supper and the Last Supper. He took the bread and he broke it and he said, "This is my body, which is broken for you. Take and eat."
Jesus also filled the cup. He filled it all the way to the top because he knew what he was about to do. He knew the purpose, and he knew the significance, not only of the event, but at the time that he was spending in the upper room. He knew that this was something that we would be practicing within the body of Christ, within the church, from generation to generation, and the importance and the value of it, so that we will never forget that the price Jesus Christ paid for all of our freedom. He says, "Do this in remembrance of me." You want to hand your cups over? The ushers will come by and they'll take your cups up.
Thank you.
I
awesome to see young people. Okay, you girls do a really good job. We appreciate you. All right, church. You got a pretty good service so far. Oops, don't trip over that, anybody. Let's go ahead and stand, if you will, church. We're going to get into God's word here in just a minute. Let's hold our Bibles up in the air. Let's say it together. This is my Bible. I am what it says I am. I have what it says I have. I can do what it says I can do. Today I'll be taught the word of God. I boldly confess. My mind is alert. My heart is receptive. I will never be the same. I'm about to receive the incorruptible, indestructible, ever-living seed of the word of God. I will never be the same. Never, 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 never be the same. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, this evening, church, we're gonna shift gears a little bit. We finished up a little bit with last month as we spoke about spiritual warfare and some of the components and some of the aspects that are associated with spiritual warfare. This evening, I'm going to shift it up a little and talk to you about something that we all deal with spiritual warfare, but I believe that to a large degree, a lot of us deal with this situation also. Next month, I'm going to get into a series on miracles. The basis of miracles, the characteristics of the miracles, the reality of miracles, and the theology that is behind miraculous events and where they stand in light of God's plan. And so we're going to do a pretty systematic study. We're going to dig into it, put a little meat on their bones, and have a little fun, see where we go with it. So this evening I'm going to talk to you about something that's in Scripture. It is predominantly throughout Scripture, and it is something that we deal with if not on a day-to-day basis, maybe we do, maybe we don't, but at some point in time, we as human beings deal with it. It's part of the human dilemma. It's part of our experience, and that is self-worth, self-esteem, if you will, a healthy sense of self-worth. Now, when I talk about self-worth, I'm not talking about self-worth in the way that it is measured in association with the way the world measures self-worth or self-esteem. A lot of the ways that the world measures, or that we even measure it, we have a tendency, we can't do that. We can do it by what we own, by our cars or by our homes. A lot of us, we can do it even by our jobs, by this job and this job. And if you notice, a lot of men, we associate our self-worth, and this is because of the design and the way that God has made men. God has made men, and he put man in the garden. When he put man in the garden, he made him a producer. What he did, he says, I want you to tend the garden. And man has always had this intrinsic being within him to produce, the labor of production. That's why when men get together, and we're all sitting around together, and we go up to each other, we go, so what do you do? It's what we do, and that's where we get our sense of self-worth, by what we do. And what we do and who we are two completely things altogether. If men that are sitting here this evening, your self-worth does not come from your job. Even though you may feel good about your job, and you may feel good about what you do, that does not merit your internal self-worth, according to Scripture. Because you may lose your job. And when your job goes away, then what happens to your self-worth? Then it goes away. A lot of us may measure our self-worth in terms of finances, and we think that we have finances or cars or vehicles or the way our money is expressed in a certain degree. I had that hang-up for a long time as I began to get established in life, I guess you can say. And some people may even get their sense of self-worth or a lack of self-worth through a form of education. Some people may feel good about themselves because they have education, and I believe in education. I think it's a good thing, but I don't think I'm any better than anyone else just because you don't have a formal education. And some people may feel less than other people because they don't have that. None of that has to do with the kind of worth, biblical self-worth, that God talks about. Why? Because the kind of self-worth that is appointed and associated with the world, it's transient. In other words, it does not last. It's here one time and it's gone the next.
You can have finances and you cannot have finances. You can be in a relationship and you may get self-worth from another person, but that person may go, and then where are you? So the type of self-worth that we have, when we based it on the world's paradigm of worthiness, it does not translate into the kind of self-worth that is associated with Scripture. Are you all with me this evening? And this is something that we have all dealt with at some point in time. And I'm not saying it's not good to feel good about yourself. Listen, if you have been blessed with a degree of good physical features and you are fine, that's all right. You look at yourself in the mirror every day and you say, I'm good looking. Okay. But don't let that be the focus and the point of where you get your sense of self-worth. But let me tell you something, because them good looks ain't going to last you forever. You ain't going to be 120 pounds forever, I can tell you right now. It goes away. And Scripture, the way Scripture associates self-worth, our identity doesn't rest in our jobs. Our identity doesn't rest in what we do. Our identity doesn't rest in our finances. Our identity does not rest in relationships, occupations, roles, or positions. Our identity rests in our placement in Christ Jesus that has been granted by the grace of God. And we have been justified, we have been solidified, we have been redeemed, and we have a place because of what Christ Jesus has done. And we have been granted communion. We have been granted peace with God. And because we have been granted peace with God, and there's nothing in this world that can take it away or remove it from us. The job will come and go. The finances will come and go. Your position will come and go. Your place will come and go. But no one can remove you from the place that God has put you in through the blessed blood of Christ Jesus. So this evening, with the time that we have left, I want to show you a little portion of Scripture where the Bible speaks to a person's sense of self-worth. And you can see some people here, you may have grown up in a household where people may not have recognized your value or your sense of worth. They may not have given you the dignity of a human being or a person or a kid. They may not have recognized your value in the home. You may have been in relationships before where someone may not have treated you in the way that you should have been treated. And it may have affected you and the way that you feel about yourself. But I am here to tell you this evening, church, that it does not matter what people say about you, because people's opinions of you are going to come and go. And I want to say another thing, church, that you have no right to express any negativity upon yourself. The only voice that you should hear is not your voice, but the voice of God into your minds and hearts. It's what God says about you that gives value and validity in who you are. And because you are made in the image of the living God, you have no right to condemn yourself or to criticize yourself. Now, you can correct yourself. You can make some changes about yourself. There's always self-improvement. I mean, my goodness, we got a new fitness center that just opened up if you want to go out and run on the treadmill. Planet Fitness just opened up. There's nothing wrong with that. But when you get to the point where you are condemning what God has made, and He has made you in the image of the living God, that is when we get into muddy waters. And I want to show you an individual in Scripture that has been so utterly raised in an environment. How many of y'all have ever been in an environment that is unhealthy? An environment that is dysfunctional, an environment that does not breed a good sense of self-worth and self-esteem, an environment that makes you feel not good about you, but bad about you, and it's magnified by the people that are around you. And I want to show you here in Scripture where this individual was raised in an environment that, for all intents and purposes, everything led to him to have the mindset that he was not worth anything. And God pulled him out of that. And God changed his mentality. How many of y'all have ever been at a point in time in your life where at one point in time you didn't feel like you were worth a whole lot? Yeah. We all have. We all have. So let's go ahead and pull that Scripture up, if you will. Pat, thank you. Pat took over. We got a new person. Thank you, Pat. You're awesome. We love you. This is in 2 Samuel chapter 9, if you want to look in your Bibles. This is in 2 Samuel chapter 9. Now, David has firmly taken possession of his throne. He has completely solidified the land. He has subdued all of the enemies. He has taken charge and possession and has granted peace through the absorption of his authority and his leadership throughout Israel. And he sits firmly upon his throne now in chapter 9. There are no more wars to fight. There are no more battles to fight. There are no enemies that are against him. There are no other people that are objecting to his place on the throne. He has conquered every single enemy and every single piece of opposition that has come against him. And now that he no longer has to fight anyone, his energy is placed elsewhere. And the interesting thing about David, and one of the things that I love about David, is David was a fighting man, but David was also a compassionate man. He was a man that sought for the interest of other people. He was the kind of leader and he was the kind of king that looked out for the people that he served. He did not have them serve him, but he served the people and he looked out for their best interest. And the first thing that he did, having had his kingdom solidified, is demonstrate kindness to one of his enemies. And that was in Saul's household. David asked, in his first act as king, having solidified his crown, he said, is there anyone still left in the house of Saul to whom I can show kindness for Jonathan's sake? That word kindness, it comes from the Greek word. It sounds like Christos in the Greek, almost like Christ or the Messiah. It actually means grace. Is there anyone whom I can show grace or to be gracious to? Is there anyone that can be of benefit because of my leadership? Is there anyone that can gain anything because of my crown? The interesting thing is a lot of people take leadership positions for the sake of self-gain and self-promotion. David understood that he took this king so that he can help and promote other people. And the first act that he did, having gained his crown, is to show compassion and grace for someone else. Whom I can show kindness for Jonathan's sake. Many of you remember that Jonathan was his covenant brother. And he loved him, and Jonathan was King Saul, the first king of Israel, was Saul's son. And so after he asked this question, he was looking for someone within Saul's household. Saul is deceased, Saul having been deceased, he having killed himself and been defeated by the Philistines, he reaches out, and in 2 Samuel 9:2, here's the response. Now there was a servant of Saul's household named Ziba. They called to him to appear before David, and the king said to him, are you Ziba, your servant? He replied. He says, yes, I am. I am Ziba. I am part of Saul's household, and I'm here at your request. I'm here at your disposal. 2 Samuel 9:3. The king asked again, is there no one still left of the house of Saul to whom I can show God's kindness? Now, the first time, he said, is there anyone that I can show kindness? Now he's illustrating where this kindness from. Listen, church, there's a certain kind of kindness that we can illustrate that comes from us as people. But when you become a believer in Christ Jesus, when you become a follower of God, there is a standard and there is a level of standard for that kindness that extends itself outside of our human nature. It compels us to do things that the average person that is not a believer in God would do. It feels good to be kind to other people. Why? Because you are investing in the people and you're doing what God has called you to do. You are in function and operation and you are working in agreement with the first commandment that was expressed in Deuteronomy. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, and mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. And as he expresses his kindness, he is in communion and agreement with the first law and fulfilling all laws by loving his neighbor. How many of y'all feel good about doing things for other people? Feels good. I was over at the donut shop the other day, and it was just something very simple. I like doing different things for different people, and people look at you like you're crazy. I don't say anything else, but they do, because you know why? Because kindness is not something that's expressed on a day-to-day basis. They're not used to it. And some lady was late, and she was standing in line, and she was getting donuts, and I was bringing a dozen donuts for the guys at Joshua House. And how many of y'all can get one of them donuts? I know you did. I saw you. Some of y'all got two of them. Okay. So when I was in line, I got some donuts, and the lady ahead of me, she didn't have enough money, and she was getting something else. And I said, you know what? I said, put it on my tab. And looked at me, she looked at me, she spun around, and she said, what? I said, just put it on my tab, ma'am. I said, I'll take care of it. Don't worry about it. I said, you're going to work? I said, it looks like you're in a hurry. Just go ahead and go on the way. I got it. Are you sure? I said, absolutely. I work at Crossroads Church. They pay me tons of money. I got this. I'm just kidding. But so she walked away, and I didn't do it for me so that I could feel good. I did it so I could show God's gracious. And I got a chance. I didn't preach her a sermon. I didn't say I'm one of the pastors at Crossroads. I didn't say anything. All I said was, God bless you. Have a good day. May the Lord bless you. Not me. May the Lord bless you. Have a good day. And just being kind to your fellow human being. Being kind. Now you don't know what somebody is going through when you're kind to them. You have no idea. You have no idea how you can be a blessing to someone. You don't know what their story is. You don't know what their day's like. You don't know what their morning's like. You don't know what their night is like. You have no idea. But when you can be kind to someone, you have no idea what kind of investment that you're placing in someone. Have you ever had someone that has been kind to you when you have had a stressful time, and it's a kindness that just comes out of nowhere, and it's an investment in you, and you're like, I really needed that. That's given me hope. It's given me encouragement. It's given me fuel to move on. And so David, he's looking to show God's graciousness. He goes, I'm not just showing any kind of kindness, but I'm showing God's kindness. I want to show God's kindness. Why? Because I don't want to get the credit here. The credit is due where the credit's due, and the credit belongs to God. The king asks, there's no one still left in the house of Saul to whom I can show God's kindness. Ziba answered the king, I want you to see this. There is still a son of Jonathan. He is crippled in both feet. I want you to see the way they identify this individual. And this individual that they identified, his name is Mephibosheth. And the interesting thing is, they don't mention his name in Scripture. This person, Ziba, does not say, well, this is his name. He's Jonathan's son, the only last son that survived, Mephibosheth. He said, he's Jonathan. He's a son of Jonathan. They mention Jonathan the father, but they say his son is a cripple. They identify him by his infirmity. They identify him by his infraction, if you will, or how they perceive him. I want to tell you something, church. There's three ways that self-esteem is viewed. There's the way that the world views us. There's the way that people view us. And then there's the way that we view ourselves. And this is the way that people viewed this young man. They didn't view him as just, he's Jonathan's son. They say he's the cripple. He's got something wrong with him. He's insufficient. Now, he didn't say that, but there's an implication behind it. He's flawed, in other words. He has a flaw. There's a certain flaw. I don't know of any person that does not have a flaw. I know of no person that doesn't struggle with some type of thing. I don't know of any person that is not a continual work in progress. I don't know of any person that has got all of their act together. I know none. I used to work around a few that used to act like they had their all together. Right? I used to be around a few church folks at one time that act like they had never sinned before. You ever been around them? I'm like, I can't even relate to it because I just got done sinning driving through the parking lot. I can't relate to you. He said, there's still a son of Jonathan. He is crippled in both feet. Go ahead and go on. Where is he? The king asked Ziba. Where is he? The king asked. He answered, he is in the house of Machir, son of Amiel, in Lodabar. And I want you to see this here. Now, Mephibosheth was the son of a king. He had all, his bloodline was that of royalty. He should have been a king, but because of what happened with his father, and because he was overcome by the Philistines, he through no fault of his own, Mephibosheth was put in a position where he was dropped as a young child. At 5 years of age, he was dropped. And because he was dropped by his caretaker, Ziba, they dropped him, and he became crippled because of the dropping. And they named him Mephibosheth, and his name literally means shame. It means shame. So even the name that they gave him, he's a cripple, and they were ashamed of him.
He says, he's in the house of Makur. He's in a home that were once where he lived in a palace as a young child. He lives in a home that is no longer his own anymore. He doesn't own anything. He owns nothing. And Amiel in Lo Debar, I want you to see this here. His name is Shame. He's living in somebody else's home. He doesn't own anything. And they took him to live in a place in a land called Lo Debar. Lo Debar. It means a place of nothing. Lo Debar. A place of nothing. The young man's name is Shame, living in a house that is on his own, having lived once in a palace, and now he's been taken to a land that is called the land of nothing, where nothing grows, where nothing moves, where even he, because of the fact that he's crippled, he lacks the ability to be mobile, but even more so to migrate out of his position, because he has been put in a place where he is unable to move and to transfer out of his style. Have you ever been in a position where you have felt like you were just stuck? You're just stuck in a certain place, stuck in a certain position, stuck in a certain mindset, stuck in a certain title, stuck in a certain role. People have placed a title on you, or maybe there's something about you that you have put yourself in, when you put yourself in a box, and you just feel stuck, and you don't know how to get out, you don't know where to get out, who to talk to get out. You don't even know if talking about it's going to be worth anything, and you're just stuck in this place of nothing, going nowhere, and you feel like you're just going through the motions, that you're really truly not living life to the extent that you could live life. Life has become flavorless and meaningless, and you're living day to day, but there's no excitement and no energy, there's no enthusiasm, and tomorrow is just one day after another, and it's no flavor to it. It's the same thing, and whatever past that you may have had in the past is gone, and you're in one place, and you're crying out for help, and you don't know how to get out. Has anybody ever been there before? This is where this young man is. He's the cripple. We haven't even learned his name yet. All we know is he's the cripple. We know what his infirmity is. We know what his dysfunction is. But we don't even know his name yet. 2 Samuel 9:6. When Mephibosheth, son of Jonathan, when Shame, son of Jonathan, the son of Saul, came to David. They finally brought him out. He bowed down to pay honor. He went down. David said, Mephibosheth, your servant. He replied, if you could see this young man that was crippled in both feet, he is absolutely no threat to the king. He, for all intents and purposes, he really doesn't have anything to offer as far as other people are concerned. And even as far as he's concerned, he's nothing. He came from nothing, the land of nothing, and he came from shame. He's ashamed of his position, ashamed of himself, ashamed of where he's been, ashamed of where he's at, ashamed that he's not further along in life than he should have been, ashamed that he doesn't have a job, ashamed that he doesn't have a relationship, ashamed that there's not people around him that love him. He has a servant, but the servant is there to serve him because the servant's been appointed, but there's no true love there. There's not a real sense of commitment. There's a commitment to Saul and Jonathan of the past, but there doesn't seem to be a firm commitment with Mephibosheth. I'm just here because I was appointed to do this, and it's my commitment to the other previous generations. It's why I'm taking care of this shameful person. Go ahead and go on. Oh, here we are. So David replies to him. He said, don't be afraid. Why did he say don't be afraid? Because any time that a king conquered an existing land, it was part of tradition that they would kill all of the existing heirs of the former king so that there would be no opposition that would come against him. And this was not David's intention. David wasn't going to ruin Mephibosheth. David was going to bless him. He said, don't be afraid, David said to him, for I will surely show you kindness. I will surely show you grace. Don't be afraid. Don't be afraid to come to me. He says, I'm going to surely show you kindness for the sake of your father, Jonathan. He says, I'm going to restore to you all the land that belonged to your grandfather, Saul, and you will always eat at my table. God says, don't be afraid to come to me. Don't be afraid. I know everything that you've done. I know that you're crippled in some areas of your life. I know there's some areas of your life that you're not proud of. I know that there are areas of life that you're ashamed of. He said, but don't be ashamed to come to me. I am going to restore to you everything that the cankerworm tried to take away. I'm going to put you in a place. I'm going to put you in this land. I'm going to restore this land. God is in the process of relocating people. He's in the process of relocating our minds, relocating our thoughts, relocating our ideas, relocating our spirit, and putting us in places where he never thought we would ever be. Listen, let me tell you something. If you have a low sense of self-esteem, or if you have an inflated sense of self-esteem, people that really think highly of themselves, you can never put yourself in a place that God can put you in. Ever. And listen, if you have a low sense of self-esteem, if you are here this evening and you have a low sense of self-esteem, and you think, I could never do this, or I could never be here, or I could never do this, I want to tell you something. God can put you in places that you have never even dreamed of. Never. I'm the son of an alcoholic. It was dysfunction. I'm not going to go into any details, but it was dysfunction. I grew up in an environment of shame. I was shame-based. I felt worthless. I felt like I was no good. I felt like I was not a good kid or not a good son. I grew up that way. I felt that way. Why else would all this chaos be in my home? And then as I grew up and I became an adult, I put limitations on myself. And I said, there's no way that I can ever do that. There's no way that I can ever do that. And finally, when you bring your crippled parts of yourself to God, and God begins to untangle those crippled areas, those areas that haven't moved, those barren areas, those areas where nothing has grown, where you haven't invested into them because you're afraid, because no one else has ever invested into them before, and you've never seen the possibilities of those areas. And God begins to breathe life, and he begins to put meat on those bones, and he begins to stand you back up, and you begin to realize who you are in Christ Jesus. Your dreams begin to change. Old men still dream dreams, and young men still see visions like you have never seen before. Ear has not heard, and eye has not seen what God has in store for you, church. Who would have ever known when I started out volunteering for that donut table years ago? I volunteered for the donut table. I thought I was Big Cheese working at the... Listen, I'm at the donut table working at the church. I'm a volunteer. Oh, don't get the sprinkles. I'm saving the sprinkles for someone else. You can get the nuts over here. Take only half a glazed. We're working on the half a glazed. They only had three at the donut shop this morning, church. God bless you. Thank you. Stay away from the donut holes. The donut holes, praise God, are for the pastor. Glory be to God. I took my donut ministry serious. I'm serious. Guarded it right here. Prayed over my donuts, my holy donuts, my blessed donuts. I never had any idea that working that donut table in those little small areas of life that God would push me into a pastor position. I had no idea. And just because I'm a pastor now, that doesn't make this donut table any less significant. It was absolutely significant. We all have to start somewhere. And you can bless people from a donut table, and you can bless people the same way from a pulpit. Because God says that you will surely eat at my table. What does that mean? That means that only God has the ability and the power to place you. That means God is going to place you. In the Old Testament, in the book of Genesis, the Bible says that God placed Adam in the Garden of Eden. That God placed Eve in the Garden of Eden. If God places you there, Satan can't move you out of there. God places you. And sometimes we move away. Sometimes we stray away. And when we stray away, God brings us back. And he says, I'm going to place you in a place of productivity. I'm going to place you in a place of vibrancy. I'm going to place you a place of divinity. I'm going to place you a place where you can move, where you can shake, where you can live, where you can breathe, where you can feel good about yourself. Not because of you, because of who I am in you and how I love you and care for you. You will always eat at my table. Now go on here. We're gonna lock this out here. And I want you to, Mephibosheth bowed down. Shame bowed down. See, because once you've got a title over yourself, or once you've been hearing something all your life,
And people have been calling you by a certain name or addressing you in a certain way. Do you know that you can actually begin to believe that thing that they call you or address you by? Not only that, but you begin to believe it and you begin to call it to yourself. And so you begin to form your identity based on other people's opinions or the world opinion or even your own opinion about yourself. And so your behavior begins to form around that which you identify with. And he bowed down. He said, what is your servant? What is your servant that you should even notice a dead dog like me? I'm nothing. I'm nobody. I'm worthless. Nobody's wanted me since I was 5 years old. No one's ever really loved me. I don't even love myself. Why would you want me? It is by grace we are saved, church. Lest any man should boast. It is by grace. Grace stood us back up. Grace grabbed you by the shirt collar and says, stand up. You are my son. You are my child. You are my daughter. Your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. You are part of the family. You are no longer an orphan, but you are a child and you live with me. You are heirs to the kingdom of God. And if you are my child, no one is going to call you a dead dog. No one is going to call you worthless. And you do not have permission to call yourself worthless ever. You do not. The king summoned Ziba, Saul's servant, and said to him, I've given your master's grandson everything belongs to Saul and his family. I've reinstated him, his land and his title and everything. Go ahead and go on. Go to verse 13. And Mephibosheth, shamed, who was no longer shamed anymore because God brought him into the household, lived in Jerusalem, the house of bread, because he always ate at the king's table. And he was crippled in both feet. But it didn't matter. Because all of us have a little bit of cripple in us. Every single one of us are crippled in some way or another. But you know what? We're still invited to the Lord's table service. We still have an invitation. And that invitation still stands. So church, this evening, the message is clear. That God is the one that determines our worth. The world doesn't determine it. People and relationships don't determine our worth. Listen, if you got to rely on somebody else to make you feel better, I guarantee you they don't feel good about themselves. They don't have it in them. And you have no right to deem yourself other than what God has called you. And God has called you worthy. Is there anyone in the house of Jonathan that whom I have shown God's kindness? Is there anyone in the house of Crossroads to whom we can show God's kindness, God's grace, God's mercy? You are worth everything to God, and you were invited to the table of his feast every day of your life, church. Y'all receive it, church. If you're here this evening and bow our heads for a minute here, if you will, and close your eyes. If you're here this evening, you've been struggling with that crippled portion of your life. It's been affecting your self-esteem, your self-worth. You've been having issues with it. It's made you feel not good about yourself in some areas. And you want to be free from it. You want to realize your full potential in Christ Jesus. Because you do have it. You have full potential. Despite whatever you may think about yourself, won't you raise your hand and let's pray for you this evening? Yeah. God sees you. God sees your brother and sister. God sees up your brother. God sees over here, brother and sister. God sees you over here to the left, your sister. He sees your sister. He sees your brother. God sees you right back there, sister. Right back here. Right up here, brother. Right up here, sister. Right way back there, sister. God sees you right up here, brother. Right here in the middle, sister. God sees you. God sees your sister. Right here in the middle, brother. God sees you. Right over here to the right, brother. God sees you. God sees you here, brothers.
God sees you. God sees you, brother. God sees you, brother. God sees you.
God sees you. God sees you right over here, sister.
God sees you right over here. Heavenly Father, we come before you in the name of Jesus, Lord. Father, we ask for your grace and your mercy. Heavenly Father, we ask for your kindness, Lord. Father, we thank you for the invitation, Lord. Help us to see us as you see us, Heavenly Father. Help us to receive your grace, Lord, and be gracious to ourselves, Lord God. Bring us relationships, Heavenly Father, that exemplify your grace, Lord. People that invest in us, Lord, not make withdrawals, but investments that continue to perpetuate, Lord. That's what you have given to Jonathan and Jonathan's son, Mephibosheth. I thank you, Heavenly Father, for the invitation, Lord. The invitation to eat at the king's table, Lord. Because we all, the only family eats at the king's table, and we are family, Lord. And we thank you, Lord, for making us, Heavenly Father, through the blood of Christ Jesus, children of the living God. We thank you, Heavenly Father, Lord, for cleansing us, Lord, from any shame of the past, for removing it from us, Lord God, and not letting it be an anchor in our lives, Heavenly Father, but freeing us from any shackle, Lord, that may entangle us and weigh us down. I ask for your grace and your mercy, Heavenly Father, and your loving kindness to be on each and every person here this evening. And I pray this in the name of Jesus and all of God's children said. We're going to sing a song here as we close, and then I'm going to have Terry Arroyo. She's going to come up here. Teen Director, Teen Challenge, Northern California. Teen Challenge, work. Come on up here. She's going to pray us out. But Carla, if you want to lead us in one song, and then we're going to have Terry come on up, and she's going to get Pentecostal on us like she does.
Side out, Lord.
God, that we not walk in the identity that the world or our past has held over us, Father God, but the identity in you, Lord God, that we are made righteous and pure and holy in your sight, Lord God, that we are children and princesses and princes of the Father. Lord God, let us walk in that confidently and boldly, Lord God, this week. Help us to minister to those around us, our families most important, but to those that are in our workplaces or that we come in contact, to show that godly kindness, Father God. It's so easy to be busy and to be rude, but Father God, give us the strength to show your love to those around us, Father God. Bless this food we're about to receive, Lord God. Be with us this week. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.